Good evening, everyone. Dr. Roland here from the KL Sky Clinic, and today is part two in regards to the pandemic fear. Yesterday, we went through a bit of the questions about the data and the legitimacy of the data, and also we discussed about the global political fiasco that is going on that actually led to the pandemic, whether we see there's a connection between all of this. So, the first thing I think we're going to talk today is the financial impact. We're going to look at two financial impact, dua jenis financial impact kepada dunia setakat ni. Tapi kita kena faham, again balik pada link semalam is the trade war. Nampak gayanya selepas akan tukarnya presiden Amerika yang baru, nampak gayanya mungkin trade war ni akan mula berakhir. Okay, Amerika akan mungkin akan pro China balik. Okay, to get all of the outsourcing and everything. So, mungkin masa Donald Trump, konsep dia make America great again, boleh tetap menjadi. Tapi yang harus diingatkan juga, waktu 4 tahun Donald Trump berkhidmat, New York Stock Exchange capai index komposit dia yang paling tinggi sekali. 30,000 financial index point. So, benda ni sangat-sangat tinggi, dan benda ni berlaku masa time pandemik. Satu benda yang nampak agaknya yang mustahil. So biasanya kita akan lihat kalau dalam satu krisis, biasanya stock market biasanya akan drop. Tapi stock market US ni cara pelik ni dia bounce back. Dan kita dapat tahu also few things, because kita kena rujuk kepada US economy, because walaupun US economy nampak ni mungkin tak sekuat other countries like China and everything, tapi US economy is still the largest economy in the world. Walaupun populasi dia 331 juta, dia merupakan populasi having the biggest economy. And then they have paling banyak duit in US dollar all over the world. And bila Fed ni namanya Federal Reserve. Federal Reserve ni macam kira macam mereka punya bank negara. Mereka boleh print duit. Tak kisahlah dia nak print duit dekat untuk buat minyak ke, print duit untuk buat apa-apa mereka nak, mereka boleh choose. And dia tak perlu tanya sesiapa pun. Dia choose nak print, dia boleh print. And bila mereka print, mereka telah print hari bulan I think in October, they printed 4 trillion USD. And semalam mereka approve lagi 2.7 trillion. 2.7 trilion ataupun 4 trilion ni lebih kurang macam 6,700 bilion dollars. Adakah angka ni sangat sikit dalam duit? Angka ni sangat besar. Kalau dibandingkan untuk Malaysia punya bajet, mungkin boleh guna untuk 20 tahun. That's how crazy the number is. It's very big number. So, siapa yang sebenarnya akan dapat duit ni? So, duit ni kebanyakan rakyat mahiran ni akan fikir, oh, duit ni akan disalurkan kepada for the normal people. Katakan macam M40 ke B40 ke yang dapat duit ni. Tapi sebenarnya, dalam mana-mana negara pun, duit ni takkan sampai dekat bawah. Dalam bawah dapat mungkin 1,600, bantuan 500, 300 and on. This is the money they get. But the big companies yang akan dapat ni. So, the big companies ni, is siapa? You akan tengok satu-satu macam mana benda ni akan berlaku and apa impact ni kepada the big world nation. So bila ada trade war berakhir, they have this much of money, 6.7 trillion USD print lah. Bila dia boleh print, apa akan jadi? Duit dia akan larut, ada dilution. Tapi US dollar terlampau banyak. So much of US dollar in the world market, dalam poket orang. So when that happens, apa yang berlaku is walaupun dia print 4.7 trillion, dia tak nampak duit itu sebab banyak sangat duit. So macam letak macam satu drop of air mawar dalam satu gelang tu tak nampak pun tukar pink. Tapi kalau letak dalam gelas kecil akan nampak. So then what happen kalau Malaysia print banyak duit, mata wang dia akan jatuh dengan banyak. Tapi US kalau dia print pun orang takkan perasan, because orang akan gunakan duit itu. And apa yang akan terjadi? Orang-orang yang kaya, what we call it as the 2%. This is, kalau you pernah tengok movie Hunger Games, These are the people. The people yang run macam Facebook yang kita tengah broadcast sekarang, Amazon, benda-benda macam Alibaba, banyak all these big countries, GM, they will get the profit. And what this 2% will do? Dia akan jadi lagi kaya. And bila dia jadi lagi kaya, something yang I boleh katakan, there's something called as Warren Buffett new index. Bila kita nampak macam stock market tu sangat tinggi and kita nampak people are selling their bank stocks, they jual bank, tapi kita nampak they, tak, they are very afraid that the banks might go into negative interest. Boleh berlaku lah, tapi tak berlaku lagi lah. Mungkin interest rate menjadi 1% ataupun nanti jadi minus 1%. That means meminta pinjam 100,000, dia bagi 101,000. Take and go, pay later, because they don't know what to do and they just need to keep people okay and spend. So that can happen, that can really happen, and that's very dangerous. Because bila 2% ni tadi terlampau kaya, this is what we call as the technocrat economy. These people yang control government sekarang, these people boleh jatuhkan kerajaan, these people boleh jatuhkan ekonomi, these people boleh beli bank. And bila dia beli bank, kepada rakyat-rakyat yang kita nampak ada moratorium, nanti moratorium 6 bulan ke, moratorium 1 tahun ke, at this moment macam takkan ada impact, because kita punya pendapatan, income, we already drop. Businesses dah jadi slow. Tak kisahlah mana-mana, everybody, klinik pun, satu dunia pun alami benda ni, because people are scared, ada fear. So when this happens, these businesses yang kaya 2% ni, dia akan belilah secara murah, secara lambat. And when you ada investments macam ada rumah, ada kereta, ada loans and everything, you cannot pay, you tak boleh bayar sebanyak yang mungkin. So what will happen? Dia kata, aku beli bank ni lah, aku offer you, I refinance your thing and everything, tapi you akan berhutang lah kepada sistem. So this 2% yang maha kaya ni akan jadi lagi kaya. So that is definitely nampak really dalam US economy. And I quote satu benda daripada Robert Kiyosaki. Kalau you tak tahu Robert Kiyosaki ni, you akan tengoklah. Dia lah penulis buku Rich Dad Poor Dad, Poor Dad ke Rich Dad ke. And he said that sangat-sangat penting, because whatever happens to the US economy is something that was going to impact everybody kat dunia ni. Kalau tahun 2008 kita nampak market crash sebab ada subprime loan and everything, kita semua kena tempias dia. So now again, another one more round of this. You must remember, even the oil price tahun ni jatuh sampai negatif $31, $31 to $35 per barrel. Sampai tak ada orang nak simpan minyak. You nak minyak, kita bagi you minyak. So all of this has been going on. And apa Robert Kiyosaki kata is, the US GDP versus dia punya loan ataupun dia punya loan is 90% pada bulan September ke Oktober. Dan bulan November hutang dia dah jadi 130%. And this is benda yang tak logik. Negara tu berhutang, bisnes dalam negara tu merundung, tapi stock market New York Stock Exchange 30,000 pecah panggung. Never have we seen this before. And benda ni macam rasa macam impossible to happen. And they can predict that this 130% ni boleh jadi 200 to 250%. That means dia macam satu bubble tu tengah mula untuk meletup. Maybe now dia belum meletup lagi, but if it explodes, then we are all done. So that is this kind of impact of the market, because market ni ada banyak orang akan capitalize on this. And bila kita balik kepada our own country kan, masa MCO pertama, kerajaan kata one day kita beli 2.6 bilion. Now CMCO kita tak boleh lanjutkan banyak sangat because satu hari kita rugi lebih kurang 300 juta dari segi bisnes. So kita dah faham dah, walaupun kes dulu dalam 3 angka and kes sekarang antara 1500 and 2000 and semua dekat hot area, hey, hot area because semua dekat city, dekat KL, Selangor and everything. So this population is a high density population between 5.5 to 6 million people kalau dah katakan the greater KL. So this number, if you see, kalau kita tunggu, apa yang jadi? Dia akan merosakkan ekonomi and the government got no choice. So sometimes the government have to make certain decision to open up because Malaysia is not as big as US ke, GDP dia tak sebesar macam Singapore ke. We don't have that much of reason compared to certain countries who can actually, oh okay, we can close and kita bayar semua orang. Tak ada, tidak dibayar. So a lot of people daripada medical akan kata, oh still have to buat CMCO protection and everything. Yes, protection is important, but now when you are at 1,005 to 2,000, let's just say kita dapat vaksin pun bulan 2 seperti yang diumumkan semalam. If we get also, the earliest we're going to get is February, from January and February, katakanlah kita tunggu sampai end of February lah, 60 days. Kalau pergerakan angka case positif is antara 1,000 to 2,000, I akan ambil max lah. Kita play safe, kita play hard sikit. You already going to have 120,000 cases. You can use all your mathematical calculation yang public health. You definitely going to reach this kind of numbers. So this is where now we see that, oh, kenapa kita tak beli vaksin awal? Kenapa kita lobby for the vaccine awal and stuff like that? So this is another situation yang kita kena tengok. Tapi another situation yang kita kena fikir juga, yang telah dibawakan oleh beberapa pemimpin kat Malaysia, whether pemimpin government ke pemimpin pembangkang, ialah penggunaan KWSP. First tu ada 2-3 profesor kampung kata, oh nak tukar, nak keluarkan KWSP ni kena tunggulah, kena tukar akta lah, kena bubal and everything, because they didn't want, they were just jadi pak turut. Ada apa yang dinamakan sebagai political will. Political will ni sangat penting because you must understand something very simple. Bantuan sara hidup 300 or 1,000 or prihatin 1,600 or 2,000 ringgit ke ataupun whatever number lah. This is kadang-kadang jadi bantuan one off. Tapi for the people who have actually lost their jobs, especially aviation, tourism, massive impact. And kalau high earner macam captain kapal terbang, high earner 10 tahun jadi first officer ke and everything, katakanlah gaji dia dah RM10,000, ni saya rasa paling busuk punya gaji dah. I think pilots earn more than this with the intensive and everything. You rasa dia tak ada rumah besar ke? Dia takkan letak investment dia yang banyak ke? Dia akan ada saving everything. And we know already almost 70%, in fact more, on people are servicing their loans, bayar loan, sama ada loan kereta, loan pendidikan, loan rumah, whatever loans, and maybe some saving, insurance and everything. So the higher you punya income bracket, the more likely the bank akan bagi you loan. Kalau gaji sedikit, kalau gaji macam cukup-cukup lah, seperti yang selalu kita tengok, gaji minima lah. Katakan gaji minima lah, RM1,500 ke RM1,300 ke. How much of loan, bank mana akan bagi banyak loan? Ada tak bank akan bagi loan untuk orang yang ada gaji RM1,500 untuk beli rumah RM300,000? Impossible. Because the bank has certain calculation that not even came. So these people are lucky. If they don't get the loans, fine, they don't have a lot of burden to the bank. But small income people tak ada job. Job dia akan jadi absolute. Job akan jadi issue. But when we see the people who have higher income, the issue happens. The issue happens that they cannot surface or repay their loans. They have to renegotiate with the bank and everything. But No government cares about this. No government cares about lantaran tu. So, it might be if you just go in for lockdown after lockdown and everything, you might hurt them. And then, on the health perspective, people are stressed. People are worried. Sebab tu, case bunuh diri and everything are very high, not just in Malaysia. Case abuse are very high because people need to eat, people need to feed, people need to pay all of this. And when the moratorium ends, they have to look at paying all of this. And this is something that is impacting people's health. Kita tak dapat nafikan that this is telah terjadi because bukannya orang-orang ni tak boleh kerja ataupun malas. Orang ni boleh kerja. Tapi, they are not given the opportunity to work because we have introduced unnecessary lockdowns globally, but not worry about something that is actually easily still can be managed. Because at the moment, kita nampak sang kita macam terlampau worry. So that is one big thing about financial impact we can see. And when we move into the bigger picture for financial impact transit pada ni, is kita kena faham 2% ni yang ultra big groups ataupun individual, dia yang control media, dia yang control bank, dia yang lobby untuk government, and they are the big pharma. These guys now will bank in to the next thing which we call as the vaccine. So you see all of these are sangat-sangat connected kepada all of this topic. And bila now we go to the vaccine thing, so a lot of people tanya macam, doctor, now what about the vaccine? So I can masuk pada vaccine part. So we see this plan, this plot going on one piece by one piece by one piece, and then now we come to what the vaccine. What about the vaccine? So vaccine, race untuk buat vaksin ni, I think daripada bulan 2-3 dah already mula kat satu dunia. And at this moment, kita dah ada banyak development of vaccine in the world. So many kinds of companies are doing it. I think antara 55 hingga 70 big pharma companies are tengah buat vaksin dekat dunia. And tapi I akan pergi kepada the few top vaccine yang telah dicipta sekarang ni, and what is the impact, macam mana benda ni berlaku. Okay, sekejap lah, minum air dulu sekejap. So, getting back to vaccine, one interesting thing I nak beritahu you, dalam dunia ni ada lebih kurang 10 noni million viruses. That means 10 darab kuasa 30 type of viruses. Lagi banyak daripada bintang dekat dunia. So it's very hard to see viruses because they are like super small, 100 to like nanometer small size, super duper small, because they are not even a living object. Virus ni bukan benda hidup pun. Virus ni hanya ialah satu protein yang ada casing. Yang tu kita faham, virus bukan bakteria. Kuman ni ialah satu protein yang ada selaput, ada shell. Dia akan masuk and dia akan copy, dia akan attack dia punya host. So that's the function and how actually the virus actually attack people and make them get infected. So banyak sangat jenis virus ada kat dunia ni. And untuk macam mamalia saja, I heard there's about more than 1.7 million type of viruses. So this is actually memang data sains boleh pergi rujuk, boleh search sendiri. Even plants pun ada virus. Tapi banyak orang kata macam plants boleh masuk virus ni because plants ada dinding sel. Virus tu tak boleh masuk host. Tapi it can be injected by insects and stuff like that. Okay, so vaccine. What we have at the moment? I have the big things about vaccine. I akan cover sekejap lagi. Benda ni I ambil daripada BBC. Nanti I akan kupas pasal the vaccine. The first one yang dapat stage is the Sputnik V. This one is the Russian one. And then kita ada Pfizer, Pfizer and BioNTech. And then kita ada the Oxford AstraZeneca punya virus vaccine, and then also Moderna vaccine. This one daripada US and Europe. Oxford is UK. This one is Russia. So Russia actually released the first vaccine pada bulan Ogos. Mereka kata mereka telah berjaya untuk cipta vaksin. Tapi bila sebab Russia je cipta benda ni pertama, biasalah budak-budak ni biasalah panas. Macam dia jadi balik macam space race. Tapi why Russia actually dapat to find the vaccine first is they were already working on MERS coronavirus. And bila dah keluar SARS-CoV-2 ni, automatically dia dah boleh dia pandai reprogram, and the release started to pull it out. Of course, Russia dia ada keberanian dia sikit lah. First, phase 1, phase 2, dia rasa kerajaan dia rasa dah selamat untuk mereka roll out. Tapi sebab mereka tak push untuk phase 3 yang terlampau laju, tapi phase 3 tengah berjalan sekarang dekat banyak negara dekat dunia. So, biasalah the east side and the west side war ni akan berlaku. Dia akan kutuk Russia punya vaksin, oh tak betul and everything. Tapi nak bagi tahu, at the moment sebelum phase 3 trial ni, dia dah nampak macam 90% vaksin dia ada keberkesanan dia. Okay, so and then Pfizer and BioNTech, they also have a new kind of vaccine. Tapi akan jelaskan perbezaan antara dua tu, because dia guna teknologi yang sangat-sangat berbeza kat sini. So Pfizer, BioNTech, Moderna, they have something called as adeno. This is the adenovirus. This is the mRNA technology. mRNA technology ni adalah macam machine purpose tag dalam our body. Dia akan copy and they will actually make certain protein. Nanti I akan tunjuk macam mana benda ni berlaku. This one, dia guna adenovirus. So Oxford, AstraZeneca and Sputnik, dia guna adenovirus. Pfizer, Moderna, dia guna mRNA punya style. So both vaccine work very very differently. Okay, so I will just rub this down a bit and I think just keep macam mana dua vaccine ni bekerja dan mana mungkin kita akan pilih. And kebanyakan trial ni semua dah masuk phase 3 punya trial lah. Semua dah masuk fasa ketiga punya trial. So fasa ketiga ni considered as the good ones lah. So Sputnik, Russian, lepas tu ada Oxford, AstraZeneca, and then we have the Pfizer, BioNTech. And then what else that miss? What's the next one I miss? Moderna. So mRNA, adenovirus. Okay. Start dengan ni. This one gunakan something quite interesting, guna teknologi DNA. Adenovirus Sputnik 5, Sputnik V daripada Russia ni, dia guna human adenovirus. So maksudnya bentuk adenovirus ni dia akan bentuk macam ni. Dia macam ada spike juga, tapi bukan macam COVID lah. COVID lain sikit. So dalam virus tu, adenovirus ni, dia akan packing satu DNA khas yang akan masuk ke dalam sel manusia setelah disuntik. Oxford AstraZeneca adenovirus ni, dia tak guna adenovirus manusia, dengar betul, dia guna adenovirus chimpanzee. Okay, maksudnya bukan mereka gunakan sel chimpanzee, eh. Tapi sebab chimpanzee ni kira boleh katakan cousin paling terdekat lah, sepupu paling dekat, paling terdekat untuk manusia. So they use a chimp virus. Chimp adenovirus. So when they use a chimp adenovirus, we know that humans ni tak terdedah sangat kepada hubungan dengan cipan ke chimpanzee, eh. So it's also the same kind of structure. Apa yang mereka gunakan is cuma casing je, casing je. That means the casing kat luar ni is the one that uses the adenovirus of the chimp. Same like here, dia guna human, kat sini dia guna chimp. So DNA strand ni ialah DNA yang mereka telah buat copy a cell. Mereka dah cari dah. Apa usaha mereka dalam risiko vaksin? Everybody is going for one thing and one thing only. When you ada COVID-19 punya virus, COVID-19 punya virus, dia nampak macam ni kan? And dia ada dia punya spike. Ada dia punya spike protein. So they call it the S protein spike. So bila virus COVID-19 ni is outside, mereka tengah nak target this one. Content RNA dalam COVID-19 ni tak ada orang kisah at the moment. Nobody cares about it. But what they can do is they can actually find apa code DNA kat dalam ni yang digunakan untuk buat benda ni saja. So bila our body nampak benda ni, dia akan anggap the spike protein is benda asing. So dia akan pergi attack. So our body will go and attack. Bila dah kena attack tu, maksudnya kita ada satu klik. Ni katakan virus, kita letak marker je terus, pak, automatically our cell darah akan go and attack. So your B lymphocytes, your T lymphocytes, all your immunity system akan terus respond and actually attack the system. I don't want to go too scientifically complex. I just want you to understand the simple things saja. Macam mana benda ni berlaku. So benda ni guna DNA. Dia guna DNA punya ni. And this is where this one jadi interesting. Katakan ni lah. Boleh nampak tak? Is it okay? Can you see? When this virus yang vaksin ni disuntik, dia akan masuk ke dalam, dia akan dock ke dalam kita punya sel. And kita punya sel, seperti you tahu, ada nucleus lah. Nucleus ni lah simpan semua information DNA kita yang kita tengok. So kat sini ada small DNA system, dia akan masuk. And for the Sputnik and Oxford, they will go into the your own body punya nucleus and do something called as transcription. And dia akan keluar and dia akan dalam this DNA ni, dia akan keluarkan satu code which is called the mRNA. So only these two virus masuk ke dalam your own nucleus. Tapi Russian Sputnik V tak bagi statement lagi how they actually interact, but I think it's the same thing. Tapi Oxford and AstraZeneca kata walaupun, okay, listen to this, walaupun the vaccine goes into the nucleus, dia takkan bercampur dengan DNA you, kata mereka lah setakat ni. Kita tak tahu lagi, ya. So it doesn't interact. And dia akan buat satu print, dia akan buat satu copy of the mRNA. And mRNA ni akan ada informasi untuk buat the spike protein. Spike protein ni lah yang macam yang kita nampak corona ni, imitakai tu. So they make the spike protein. So bila spike protein ni dikeluarkan oleh sel, dia akan hantar keluar, badan kita automatically akan target, okay, benda ni lah benda asing, benda ni lah benda luar, attack. So bila dia attack, dia akan jump the spike protein and we will build again our own immune system. Of course, benda ni sangat complex. Got your B lymphocytes, your T cells, your memory T cells, plasma, everything works to produce this immunity system. So that is how this DNA system works. Pfizer, Moderna, concept is lagi interesting because dia tak gunakan any casing of adenovirus, any casing of virus daripada yang digunakan dan dijumpai dalam cipan and everything. Dia gunakan mRNA. mRNA is dia hanya akan gunakan lipid casing. It means lipid lemak ni mereka boleh buat sebab kebanyakan our body punya membrane cell ni buat daripada lipids, phospholipids. So phospholipid ni dia akan letak mRNA punya copy kat dalam. So when dia masuk ke dalam kita punya cell, automatically dia akan datang, dia akan paut kat sini, dia akan melekat dan dia akan bebaskan the mRNA. Bila dia masuk kat sini, automatic kita punya mesin fotokopi, kita namakan dia ribosome. Orang yang pergi science stream mesti tahulah. Dia akan masuk dan dia akan buat copy and they will make again the spike protein. Spike protein ni akan keluar. Spike protein ni akan keluar and badan kita akan detect, tentera badan kita lah. Tentera akan detect and build immunity. That's how Pfizer BioNTech. So this is technically not even virus shelling, I think. This is technically the technology yang we have never used before. Kita tak pernah gunakan teknologi sebelum ni. Nak kata teknologi tu bagus bagi saya, fantastic. This is science. Benda yang mungkin ambil 10 tahun nak buat because of all the scientific team and research and everything we develop this. But that doesn't mean ada tak ada tangan-tangan gelap kat dalam ni. Masih ada. Masih ada. Because in terms of the name of science, I think scientists, they like this. Sama macam people like us. Even though doctors, we will tell you that we are scientists first. We are science-based people. So, we need to appreciate what the scientific data ada kat sini. So, this is how vaccine tu akan terbentuk. So, bila katakan badan kita diserang oleh COVID punya sel ataupun coronavirus, katakan COVID-19 lah, ada banyak coronavirus lain, so benda tu pun akan didiscuss future. So badan kita terus akan tangkap, oh spike protein ni terus tangkap, I kenal, I cap muka ni. Sama macam kalau pergi perhimpunan, bersih ke tak bersih ke, and there was chemical water. Kalau ada semua chemical water dah berwarna tu, orang dah cam dah, budak brand dah kena simbah. So it's easy for the military or the defense system or police to actually attack the virus, and that's how it's going to work on this. So we see this technology still very new. So sebab tu all the research and everything, ada research dah masuk phase 3. Oxford is already masuk into phase 3 with a bit of redesign. Sputnik 5 pun dah masuk phase 3 at the moment. Moderna, I'm not too sure whether they phase 2 finish and going to phase 3 lah. Tapi this is what yang kita nampak. So kita ada DNA and mRNA. Things that kena beritahu is, ada tak ambil vaksin ni akan membantu kita untuk menangani COVID yang lain yang mungkin datang, ataupun MERS COVID and everything. We don't know yet. I think still akan ada research yang akan bersusulan in the moment, because coronavirus ada 4 jenis. I baca dia ada alpha, beta, delta and gamma kind of strain. So the 4 types of coronavirus strains, not the COVID-19 thing. Tapi yang kita nampak at the moment, another issue with the thing, bila dah time keluar vaksin ni, nampak something fishy also. Sama ada lepas Trump kalah je terus the Pfizer vaccine was out, we can see that thing. So again, technology is technology, kita tak dapat dinafikan. Tapi sama ada kita akan dipaksa untuk ambil vaksin ni, I tak tahu. Kalau saya suruh saya jadi clinical trial untuk buat vaksin, saya takkan join lah. Tapi terpulang lah tu individual yang perspektif. Because when you look into the vaccine, now we go for this. This is where the money lies. Can you see this at the moment? Okay, can you see? Ni I ambil pada BBC ya, bukan utusan cap ayam ke or any metro, kangkung, everything. No. AstraZeneca 8.19 billion pound. Dapat dapat duit. Siapa fund? Kerajaan fund. Siapa non-profit? Inilah golongan-golongan 2%. Alibaba, Gates Foundation and everything. And then, private. You see Pfizer? Dapat 2.2 billion. Novavax, this is the Chinese vaccine. GSK, Sanofi, Moderna and everything. So we can see how much of money already in the market for vaccines, because there's a lot of money to make. It's a lot of money to make. And another extract yang I ambil daripada BBC juga, which vaccine akan jadi yang paling murah ataupun paling mahal. So it seems to me that kalau kita tengok pada yang telah keluar cepat tu, Pfizer $18 to $19, letak $19 lah. AstraZeneca between $4 to almost $8, and Sputnik V RM10, Russian one. So we can already see a few things that the funding for certain vaccines tak ada. Russian vaccine fully state funded. Russian government funded the vaccine 100% through their investment funds. Here we can see the price of the vaccine. So if you were to inoculate people dengan with all these vaccines, semua kena buat 2 round. At least antara 20 days to 30 days kena cucuk 2 kali. So there will be 2 times kalau orang nak pergi cucuk vaksin. So, and then bila kita balik kepada price of the vaccine, ada banyak isu at the moment berkenaan vaksin. Non-disclosure agreements and everything. Kena semua kena sign NDA kepada Big Pharma. So yang kita kena faham, I think semalam ada banyak isu yang orang tanya kenapa kita beli vaksin mahal ke murah. I think my answer to that is tengok siapa yang fund. Siapa yang fund. Mungkin siapa yang jadi funder dahulu tu, mungkin they might get a better price. Because kita kena understand yang funder-funder besar ni lah US government, UK government, EU government. They have put the first duit. Duit pertama dia dah masuk dah bagi dekat Big Pharma ni. To actually maybe seed and get the first lot, the first batch of vaccine. Kita biasalah lambat sikit lah, tunggu dah lihat. Selalu tunggu dah lihat. Orang makan dulu baru kita makan. Katanya sopan. Tapi tak. Because you see certain countries like Singapore, they already got the Pfizer vaccine already. Whether the vaccine now is going to be delivered to us fast, apparently the ministers yang actually involved in this kata mungkin seawal bulan February je akan datang. So we know that we can already do the bio stats. Kalau KL ada hot zone, how many cases will actually go up. So what we want to say is that the NDAs is to protect not you or me, but most likely to protect the big pharmas, so that mereka tak kena saman sekiranya apa-apa berlaku. Because you must understand, some vaccines, even though they are manufactured, dia bukan dia kira macam say biological origin. That means dia tak boleh ambil patent for certain things. Certain patents dia akan jadi limited. So dia tak boleh kena saman. Kalau ada apa-apa sakit berlaku kepada people, kita tak boleh saman the company or saman the government or everything. Mesti ada banyak NDA like this yang akan tersorot pada kita. And standard lah. Tapi yang paling pelik ni, air pelik kenapa banyak negara dunia tak transparent dalam vaksin ni. Because kalau vaksin tu tak transparent, akan ada isu yang pertikaikan siapa yang akan ambil vaksin. Walaupun vaksin tu ada, walaupun vaksin tu free, the vaccine is not free. The vaccine still is taxpayers' money. And who can take the vaccine? Buat masa ni, I think bawah umur 15 tahun and everything, nobody's going to get. Pregnant women, they're not, most likely they're not going to give. They're going to give people who are maybe above 50 years ke, 60 years ke, we don't know. Setiap country akan ada dia punya perspektif dia masing-masing. So, some people are keeping quiet, playing this safe game, I rasa, because there's a lot of money to be made on the vaccine. Both government and also the people who are kaki cucuk, just like us. You think many doctors are silent, whether they want to be pro-vaccine or keep quiet, wait and see and everything. So if you were to ask me, I cannot comment on this at the moment because ada banyak benda we have to see in terms of the safety and the effect and everything. Because simple side effect setakat ni adalah ada orang bila ambil vaksin ni, apa yang kita nampak daripada research yang the latest ni, ada orang ada sakit badan, sakit dekat lokasi tu, ada demam, ada penyakit, ada macam pening-pening, sakit kepala, those are the mild symptoms lah. Tapi apa yang we can from the vaccines, we know that the chances of you after getting inoculated reduce your chances of getting the virus. And if you kena pun, kalau immune system you tak kuat, you might get some symptoms but not as teruk as sampai masuk ke dalam ICU anything. Tapi again, choice is yours. I think setiap rakyat kat dunia ni kena diberi pilihan sama ada dia nak cucuk ke tak. Because even though you dah cucuk vaksin, bukan bermakna you tak perlu pakai mask, cut control, app scanning, checking your data, tracing mana-mana you pergi, semua benda tu akan masih berterusan. And kita tak tahu sama ada benda tu akan berterusan as the new normal. So your freedom is limited. Okay, these things are something that yeah, mungkin kita kena ponder ataupun dan kita kena tengok. And the last but not least, bila kita rujuk kepada 4 vaksin, everybody terhege-hege pasal vaksin. Satu dunia, termasuk our government also, everybody. But one thing yang kita tak tengok is to increase our immune system. Kenapa tak ada kerajaan kat dunia ni yang bila ada wabak ni suruh tingkatkan immunity you, pastikan you makan sehat. Inilah makanan-makanan yang boleh improve your immunity, certain vitamin seperti vitamin D. Ada banyak paper yang dah keluar pun untuk berkenaan dengan penggunaan vitamin D sampai antara 1000 IU until 10,000 IU pun ada. Ataupun kalau tak ada duit, pergilah dekat matahari dan berserah kepada matahari tu at least 20 minit ke sehari to increase your vitamin D juga. Because vitamin D development ni, I dah memang dah bercakap pasal benda ni dah lama. And tapi tak pernah sekali pun kita tengok kementerian-kementerian kita ataupun kat dunia suruh orang boost up your vitamins, eat properly, eat healthy, we create good content untuk you. Because all this study ada, kalau tak percaya pergilah cari kat internet that how vitamin D and everything improve your immunity against the virus, especially the current pandemic yang kita ada. So bila kita tengok there no focus on this immunity, benda ni jadi hard sell, sell this and shut people up. So I think to wrap up, immune system is very important. We have to look at the usage of vaccine. It will come. People kena dibekalkan dengan semua information, transparent, sama ada mereka nak sudi nak ambil vaksin ke tak. Kita tak boleh paksa orang ambil vaksin seperti vaksin-vaksin lain. Kita tahu vaksin tu ada keberkesanannya yang bagus. Some people choose to, some people do not choose to. Some people feel that takpelah, bila dapat virus ni dia akan dapat sesemua demam and everything and they get through with life. Tapi ada things yang mungkin akan jadilah. Akan ada benda-benda macam global passport WHO untuk vaksin. So kalau you tak cucuk vaksin, you boleh hanya mungkin duduk dekat Malaysia saja under your own payung. You tak boleh keluar daripada negara lain because they will actually make it mandatory. So when they make it mandatory, more money lah. So even if you see like AstraZeneca, if they charge apa harga dia? $4 US for the vaccine, and they actually going to maybe vaccinate 2 billion people dalam 2 dos. So dah ada berapa? $16 billion investment you. Cuma ni pun investment ni kena fikir. Investment ni datang daripada government, kerajaan saja besar keluarkan duit, keluarkan daripada non-profit and private. So there is a lot of cash in the market. So this is how all of this wrap up. So thank you again for watching. Terima kasih kerana tonton. You can share this content. Benda ni sangat-sangat informative and very educational to y'all. At least dalam bahasa Melayu, you faham apa benda-benda yang ada, apa teknologi yang mereka gunakan. Tapi kalau nak tengok dalam bahasa Inggeris, ada banyak content yang ni. I pun semalam tidur sampai pukul 4 pagi because prepare benda ni yang betul supaya you guys actually faham all of this. And kepada semua orang dekat luar sana yang macam mengutuk kami lah and said that, oh, you guys are not frontliners. I got something to tell you lah. I've never told this online eh. So masa time COVID-19 to hit, my mother was diagnosed with cancer. Okay? And her stage was stage 4. And I was still doing contact tracings for all these foreigners ataupun orang Malaysia yang memerlukan saringan ke rumah dan sebagainya. We were doing screenings at car parks, drop house to house screenings. All of this was done. And it was very fearful. Bagi saya sangat takut because my mom is on her last days. And in order for me to go out and come across a positive patient, the amount of risk that I had to go back home, pastikan mandi betul-betul, and every day I akan pergi jumpa dia sebelum dia meninggal dunia. And for people to say that, hey, you know what, you guys have not been frontliners. Now, I was actually sitting with an ultra super duper high risk patient that I had to see every day until she actually had the last breath. And what I'll say is that I had to make sure that she was not getting the virus. I had to make sure all the doffing, donning, everything was done right. So it's easy for you to say that, you know what, we are guys are not frontliners. Come on, kita masih tengah buat screening. Virus is real, tapi pandemic management nampak gayanya nampak macam was right. Lepas tu nampak songsang because of cash and power. Tapi all the people in the world are now suffering because of this. So physicians, specialists and everything, you do what you do and you do it best. We do what we do and we do it best. So we have to take care of ourselves, still keep ourselves protected, still keep ourselves safe, use proper hygiene, kesihatan kendiri sangat penting. All of these are very important and we have to work on this whole thing together. But choice is yours. You choose to be protective, you'll be protected. We cannot put certain choices because you like it. You want the inside of it, but go ahead and do that. We show ourselves the best outside there. People are watching. So, thank you guys. This will be maybe my last video for this year. It's been a video that I memang tunggu lama untuk buat video ni. Persiapan buat video ni is very detailed. Thank you to all my team yang buat content, who makes the content in our clinic, who produce it, who edit it. It's a task for us to do it because.